This is the video for Lab 6, Classification of Chemical Reactions. This experiment has perhaps more chemistry in it than any other of our experiments. And in this experiment, you're looking at four different kinds of chemical reactions. You're predicting products, coming up with the correct formulas for products, balancing equations, coming up with net ionic equations, so lots and lots of chemistry. Let's look at the pre-lab review page first. Question number one always begins with this question: are there any safety alerts? And again, what you'll do is look for the triangle icons. Number two, any disposal directions? Here you'll look for the garbage can icons. And the rest of these questions are pretty straightforward. I don't think you'll have any problem with them. As long as you scan and read the experiments, you should be in fine shape. Let's look at the data and report page now. The first type of reaction that you'll look at is are combination reactions. Remember that these take the form of two materials, A plus B, coming together to form C. And we'll look at the combustion of magnesium and the reaction of HCl and NH3. When something combusts, it combines with oxygen. We could call that the burning of magnesium, if you will. And it fits our pattern of two materials coming together to form one product. Up here in the observations area, you'll want to note things like color change, the formation of any solids, and the formation of any gases. Those are the three observations that we typically use to indicate that a chemical process has occurred. And I'm going to help you a little bit with blank one down here. The reaction of magnesium plus oxygen. Well, we're guided in that these are our two reactants, and it's a combination reaction, so I know that the magnesium and oxygen are going to come together. We predicted the product of this reaction. The second step is to make sure that we've got correct formulas. Well, magnesium is an element all by itself. Oxygen, we know, likes to travel around in pairs, so it's correct to write it as O2. Then let's make sure we've got the right formula for magnesium oxide. Magnesium is found in group 2 in the periodic chart. It likes to form a 2 plus ion. Oxygen likes to form a 2 minus ion. It's found in group 6A. So 2 plus and 2 minus balances each other. The number of electrons transferred is 2, and so that's the correct formula for magnesium oxide. And the third step, sometimes students like to move this step up and they try to balance the equation before coming up with the correct formulas, but make sure you do this last. To balance this equation, I want to have the same number of elements on each side. Magnesium, magnesium, one oxygen, two oxygens. Well, I'll show you a little trick that oftentimes works. If I've got an odd number of something on one side and an even number of oxygens on the other side, the only way they're only ever going to balance is if we even up the odd. In other words, if I put a 2 in front of this MgO, now I'd have two oxygens on the right, we've got two on the left, and then finally, one last step, we'd have to come back to the left-hand side and put two magnesiums there. Then you'd have a correctly balanced equation. And you'll go through that process to show the combination of HCl and NH3. In part B, you'll be looking at decomposition reactions. And these follow the form A goes to B plus C. One starting material, two products. We'll be looking at the decomposition of KClO3 and H2O2. And again, I'll help you with one of these blanks and get you started a little bit and leave the other one up to you. When KClO3 decomposes, a gas is given off. And chances are it's oxygen gas, because when you test a burning wood splint, it grows brighter in the presence of this O2. KCl is the other product. Well, we've predicted the products, and we have the correct formulas, because potassium is in group 1A, likes to form a 1 plus ion. Chlorine or chloride is in group 7A, likes to form a minus 1, a plus 1, and a minus 1 balance each other. O2, we know it likes to travel around in pairs, so we've got the correct formula there. And finally, the last step would be to balance the equation. Well, hey, notice this. O2 on the right, an even number of oxygens. Over here on the left, we've got an odd number of oxygens. So try that little trick, evening up the odd. Put a 2 in front of KClO3, and then adjust the coefficients over here on the right-hand side. Let's look at Part C. In Part C, we're looking at single replacement reactions, two of these. And single replacement reactions take the form A plus BX goes to B plus AX. A is an element, BX is a compound, and A kicks out B, so the products have an element and a compound, a different element and a different compound. And here again, when you look at the photos, you'll want to look for solid formation as evidence that a reaction has taken place. Let's look at this first one, AgNO3, silver nitrate plus copper. And so I know what the starting materials are. Here's the silver nitrate, here's the copper. So copper is the element all by itself. It's going to kick out silver. So here's silver as a product, and copper has taken its place in combination with nitrate. So I've predicted the products, silver and copper nitrate. And now let's make sure we've got the correct formulas for these products. Silver's all by itself, no problem there. Copper and nitrate, how do I know that there are two nitrates? Well, the table on the next page or two of this experiment shows you the common ions that are used in this experiment. And nitrate is a minus 1, copper is 2 plus. So it's going to take two of those nitrates in combination with the copper. So that's the correct formula. The last step now would be to balance the equation. If I've got two nitrates there, then I'm going to have to place a 2 in front of silver nitrate. If I do that, I'll have to place a 2 in front of the silver over on the right-hand side. So I think we've got the equation correctly balanced now. The important step for you is just to remember that always balance the equation last. Now, that's the molecular formula. To come up with the total ionic, we're going to ionize, to break apart into ions everything that we can. Silver is a plus 1, so we'll get two of those plus 1 ions. Nitrate is a minus 1, we're going to get two of those nitrates. And again, I know the charges because of the table on the next page that helps us with the charges of these common ions. Copper's all by itself, I'm just repeating it, it doesn't have a charge. And then over on the right-hand side, silver now, because it's all by itself, doesn't have a charge. Copper, we said, would be a 2 plus, and I've got two of these nitrates that are balancing it. So there's the total ionic equation. The third step is to come up with the net ionic. And to do that, we look for common ions that are on the left-hand side and the right-hand side in exactly the same form. And I see two nitrates and two nitrates. Everything on the left is over here on the right, but typically they're in different forms. So silver on the left is a plus one, silver on the right is zero. Copper on the left is zero, copper on the right is two plus. So they're not common ions, but the nitrate is. And if I subtract out the nitrate, we're left with 2Ag plus, plus copper goes to two silvers, plus copper two plus. And that's our net ionic. And notice that the charges also balance. Two pluses, two pluses. Well, I'll leave that next one for you. There are three blanks for the molecular ionic and net ionic equation. Let's look at a double replacement reaction. There are four of these reactions now. We carry out the reaction with copper nitrate with each of these three substances, silver nitrate with each of these three, and iron nitrate with each of these three substances. So there are nine different reactions. Four of them result in solid formation. That is to say, a reaction takes place and we get different products. Double replacement reactions take this form. AX plus BY goes to BX plus AY. A and B simply swap positions. Okay, well, and the reaction that I'm going to show you is this one. Copper nitrate plus sodium hydroxide. Those are the two starting materials. Let's look at the table at the top of the next page. It asks for reactants that form a solid. Here are two of those, and you'll have three more pairs of reactants that form solids as you do this. And then column two, ionic form, I'm going to break copper nitrate apart. Copper two plus, two nitrates, sodium hydroxide, Na likes to be a plus one, OH likes to be a minus one. And the reason that we've broken these apart is so that we can rearrange them now for our swapping of ions. Copper was combined with nitrate, but now we're going to combine it with hydroxide to give copper hydroxide. And how do I know that there are two OHs? Well, we know that copper is a 2 plus, OH is a minus 1. It's going to take two of those. So we have this formula. Okay, let's do what we did in part C. We'll come up with the molecular formula, the total ionic, and the net ionic. I know these are the two reactants. Then we predicted this is one of the products. The other product would be sodium nitrate. And we've indicated it here. Because there are two nitrates on the left, we have to place a two on the right, two sodium nitrates, come back to the left and place a two in front of the NaOH. And we're all set. Blank two, the total ionic equation. Breaking copper nitrate apart, we get two plus for the copper, two nitrates, two sodium ions, two hydroxide ions. Here's our product, and I've repeated it because the solid is sitting on the bottom of the test tube. It doesn't break apart into ions. Even though it's ionic, it's insoluble, and so it's not going to break apart into ions. Two sodium ions and two nitrate ions. Let's look for the common ions. Two nitrates and two sodiums are on the left and on the right. And if we subtract those out, we get the net ionic equation. Copper 2 plus plus 2OH to give copper hydroxide. And these net ionic equations are sort of valuable for chemists because what this says to us is that any source of copper 2 plus plus any source of hydroxide ion is going to give a reaction and give us copper hydroxide. Sort of like a generic reaction. These next three I've left for you. Every reaction has three blanks, and so you'll do a molecular ionic and a net ionic. And remember to proceed in this way. Predict your products, come up with the correct formulas for the products, and then the last step would be to balance the equation. Lots of good chemistry there. Here's that table that I was telling you about, table 6.6, that shows the ions and their charges. Let's look at the questions at the end of the experiment. A student carries out a reaction in which a single reactant gives products. That implies to me A goes to B plus C. So let that help you as you decide among those choices. And number two, copper carbonate is heated strongly. A glowing splint immediately goes out when it's inserted into the mouth of the test tube. Well, as you look at A, B, and C responses, see which of those products might cause a flame to go out. That'll help you a little bit. And number three, which are spectator ions? I'm not sure that I used that word before. I talked about common ions, but they're called spectator ions. Which are on the left and on the right in exactly the same form? And number four, hey, look at part D and the reactions of silver nitrate, and that'll help you with question four. And finally, number five, get out your pencil and try writing the reaction and see what forms, see what conclusion you can make. Hey, I hope you've had fun with the experiment. Remember that you can call me or email me anytime. Thanks.